SBIRD is an evidence-based practice. S stands for the screening, the BI stands for brief intervention, and the RT stands for referral to treatment. It is an evidence-based practice that prepares health professionals at any level. My name is Jayashree Nimmagada, and I am a faculty member at the School of Social Work at Rhode Island College. I've been working with the Alpert Medical School in their interprofessional activities for 8 or 9 years now. So that partnership is what propelled us to write this grant together.
At most medical schools, I think we've struggled to keep up with the amount of individuals who are suffering from opioid misuse or substance misuse in general. And so when this grant application came around, we felt like it was a good opportunity to introduce more substance abuse curriculum at AMS.
So unfortunately, in Rhode Island, opioid overdoses, and this is often prescription opioid overdoses, leading cause of accidental death in the state. When we think about what we as medical professionals are going to face as our patients, we know that substance use disorders are going to be a big part of that.
We have incorporated training in quite a few different components of the curriculum. In our doctoring course in year one, students learn about motivational interviewing, and they actually are required to go out into their community mentor offices and practice and perform SBIRT.
In our grant application, we wrote that we would screen almost 30,000 individuals for substance misuse disorders using our medical students, nursing students, pharmacy students, social work students, and that we would refer about a third of those folks, so 9,000 folks for treatment. And so in a small state like Rhode Island, you know, when you're screening 30,000 people and you're referring 9,000 of those for treatment, you're making, I think, a big dent into the opioid epidemic.
Just grab a door sheet. You only need one per group. It tells you your patient encounter. Negotiate your roles. Go in. You'll have a faculty member in the room.
Our interprofessional workshop involves nursing students, medical students, social work, and pharmacy students.
Students learn through simulation, so it's just not a didactic lecture on here is what SBIRT is. So we actually hire medical actors.
This is Jones. I'm John. I'm the social worker at the hospital. Nice to meet you. How are you feeling today?
We have literally faculty from every single health profession from each of our institutions all work together to pull off this workshop.
When you're in your own world as a medical student, you're very much used to working with other medical students and getting to see how other professionals are taught and what they've been learning and what they can really bring to the care of your patient is something that you won't get to see unless you have a chance to work with them.
Tells you he does his best to use new needles.
He became addicted to Percocet after he injured his back in a car accident. After running out of money, he switched over to heroin.
We do a complicated case scenario, and they essentially work through a case and try to then combine their information, their knowledge base.
You want to go treat him in the hospital, and then he goes to a rehab, then we can do physical therapy there. Because the strength isn't bad, it's just the shoulder pain.
Are they shaking? Are they having upset stomach?
Okay.
And then you
there's a lot going on, would you say, with this person?
Where are
and
you
on top
right
of it, they love it because they have very hands-on 4.5 hours of training.
He needs the doctor.
So it'll be more cost-effective. Physician can prescribe housing as the treatment.
I think this patient would be a very good candidate.
When we start to incorporate alternative views that we never would have considered, it just makes it so much more of a full picture that we see the person as a person and not just as a diagnosis.
We do the entire curriculum in the morning and then with a whole separate group of students in the afternoon repeat the curriculum. So I think it's a total of about 500 students.
Do you want to do that or do you want me to?
Because of this interprofessional aspect of this training, they are able to identify their own role.
So when did the heroin use start?
About 5 months ago when I couldn't get any more Percocet.
Do what works for you.
Yeah, if there was something like at night so I wouldn't have to, you know, call off work.
And that was terrific. You know, and those subtle little things like sitting down, which I'm guessing was very deliberate on your part, and then you sat down later.
Like, that was awesome. Like, it just fit. Everyone fit really well. And then you came in with that great question about did the Percocet work with you. Yeah. Felt really great.
I like to tell our students that medicine is no longer an individual sport. It's really a team game. And as medicine becomes increasingly more complex and we need to treat individuals more holistically from a medical standpoint, it's really important to know what social workers are expert in and what nurses are expert in. And you know, defer when it's appropriate to their expertise.
Everybody rotates through the different components so that, for example, one part is the naloxone training, and we have a PharmD who does the naloxone training, but we also have pulled in lots of different people to help.
We actually get training kits. They're little kits that have the naloxone in it, and we go step by step through how to administer naloxone.
Halfway, and the rest of it will be released in the other nostril halfway.
Okay.
Where do you
so
press
that
here?
Would be the end.
Down.
You would push that right on.
So that not only can our students do it should they be in a situation where they need to, but they can teach their patients how to do this. That's really one of the key parts of having naloxone and Narcan available.
The two medications that we predominantly use to treat opioid misuse is either Suboxone or Methadone. You need a special waiver to prescribe Suboxone, and most physicians don't go after that training. It's 8 hours, it costs a fee. We're the first state in the country to allow a medical school's curriculum to account for data waiver training. You know, theoretically, we could have 140 students each year graduate who are data waiver trained and go exponentially grow the number of physicians who can prescribe these medications to individuals who suffer from opioid misuse.
So we have had the grant for 3 years, and then all of this shouldn't stop, right? Because the crisis hasn't stopped.
I think we are completely invested in continuing this and to continue to think about ways to innovate, but I think it really spurred a great deal of interest and activity in the area.
One of the sustainability measures we have taken is that we have embedded the ESPERT curriculum into our regular courses.
The screening and brief interventions fit very nicely into the doctoring course and our clinical skills course, because that's where they learn how to get information and to do some counseling of our patients.
We'd like to develop a website around ESPERT and resources in Rhode Island that folks can refer to. And hopefully we'd like to expand this, the interprofessional workshops, to first year medical students. So really get students working together in interprofessional teams even earlier than they are now.
We all come together for all this training, and I think that's very unique, that we are able to have a private school, public school partnership. It speaks to our strength, actually.